At more than 25 feet, a full-grown Dunkleosteus was almost as long as a London bus. And at over 3 tons, twice the weight of a compact automobile. And it was very likely a cannibal too, preying on smaller specimens, weighing maybe 400 pounds. With his ferocious appetite, Dunkleosteus remained top of the food chain for some 20 million years.
Tyrannosaurus, one of history's most fearsome mega predators. But now, a new discovery joins the ranks of killer carnivores. And this one was a genuine giant. 48 feet long, weighing over a ton, the largest prehistoric snake ever found, Titanoboa. T-Rex and Titanoboa lived in different times and on separate continents. But what if these two monsters met in a battle to the death? T-Rex brings to the fight a bone-crushing jaw, a bite force nearly twice a great white shark's, powerful legs, and a thrashing tail. Titanoboa's attack didn't depend on poisonous venom. It killed by constriction. And this mega serpent squeezed with a crushing 400 pounds per square inch of pressure, equivalent to being squished with the weight of 3 Eiffel Towers. How would this death match conclude? Difficult to say. If T-Rex got in a swift bite, it could mortally wound the snake. But with the right ambush, Titanoboa might trip up the T-Rex and succeed in overpowering the great lizard king.
Most amphibians fit inside the palm of your hand, but the ones assistant curator Matt Evans keeps behind the scenes could chomp your fingers off.
All right, guys, follow me. We're gonna come around here to the other side of this large aquarium. Do you guys know what this is?
No.
This is a giant Japanese salamander.
Yeah, look at that, isn't that amazing? It looks like a dinosaur.
How big do you think they get? Have any guesses?
8 feet?
8 feet, that's not bad. These guys can get to be about 5 feet long.
Oh.
And they can weigh close to 60 pounds.
Oh.
I'm guessing that's probably bigger than both of you guys right now, right?
Yeah. I'm 57 pounds.
Salamanders are one of the most ancient species on Earth, dating back 200 million years to the age of the dinosaurs. Their ability to adapt has helped them survive 3 mass extinctions.
So these guys are really neat. They actually breathe through their skin. All this extra layers of skin on their legs and kind of along their body help pull oxygen out of the water to help them breathe.
Their eyes are small because they don't rely on them for hunting.
They have these little warts kind of all over their face.
Yeah.
And they run all along the side of their body.
Oh, yeah.
It's an external sensory organ. It's called a lateral line, very similar to a fish. So they can pick up on vibrations in the water. So if they're kind of sitting and waiting in ambush, ready to hunt.
How sharp are the teeth?
Well, right here, I have a giant Japanese salamander skeleton.
Oh, it's got 2 rows of teeth.
Oh, yeah.
Well, it's actually got a 3rd row, okay?
Oh.
So it's got a top, a bottom, and then right in here, can you see it's got 2 rows in the top?
Oh, yeah.
Right? So when it clamps down on a fish, it pins it. Pins it to the bottom. And that way, nothing can get out. If it's holding on to something, nothing's getting back out.
What do they eat?
Well, they eat just about anything they can fit into their mouths. But Kyle's going to feed them right now. So right now, we're going to offer them some small fish called a smelt. You want to check that out?
Yeah.
Remember those bumps we pointed out on her body earlier? She's going to rely on those to pick up on the movement of the fish.
Oh!
There you go. Mouth open wide.
That's really quick. Yeah, real fast. That's cool. Look.
All right. right, so do you guys want to help me feed?
Yeah.
Okay. Oh. Move in front of them. Very good. Go a little closer. Oh, yeah. There you go. Awesome.
Let it go.
All right, let it go. There you go. Good job.
This giant aquatic scorpion, almost 3 feet long, was one of the first predators ever to emerge on planet Earth. The primeval oceans teemed with many different species of scorpion-like creatures. The largest sea scorpions, or Eurypterids, reached more than 7 feet long, 1,000 times the weight of the largest scorpion alive today. And research indicates that Eurypterids like to devour members of their own species, taking down prey weighing maybe 180 pounds. What puzzles some researchers is how sea scorpions were able to crunch through their well-armored prey. A modern-day scorpion may provide the answer. Paleobiologist David Marshall is going to analyze the components of a modern-day scorpion's weapons.
Well, we managed to get a scorpion exoskeleton, and we took the teeth from that, and we put it in the microscope. You can see here that we've got the teeth of the scorpion, and all of the teeth are white, which means that they're made out of the heavier elements. So we've got a spectrum here which shows all the different elements. And if you look at the teeth, what you can see is that there's a little spike of zinc here.
It turns out that the claws have metal in them. This concentration of zinc in the claws is a natural process, which evolved over time to make modern scorpions more efficient predators. But he's enlisted the help of a blacksmith to investigate just how those metal-tipped claws may have worked. At his forge, in the heart of the English countryside, the blacksmith will make two steel sword blades. Both will be identical to the naked eye, but one will be given a specially hardened cutting edge, just like the scorpion's claw. It's a process known as case hardening, where the outer surface is coated with a compound that increases the carbon content, and therefore the hardness of the steel blade.
Adding carbon to metal increases its strength, and so too does adding metal to the cuticle of arthropods changes their material properties.
We're putting a hard skin onto what would be a soft piece of metal. But on the case-hardened area, it just glides straight off. It's absolutely solid. First, we've got our mild steel blade. We'll see how it performs against a piece of oak and see if the blade sustains any damage. Straight away, you can see we've lost the edge. We've significantly dulled the edge. Prolonged use of the blade against this piece of wood would severely damage the edge. Now we'll see how the case-hardened blade compares.
The sword is as sharp as ever because of that hardened outer skin. But how well can it slice through flesh, like a hungry sea scorpion had to do?
Now we've made our hardened blade, all we've got to do is really test it. I'm gonna do that on this piece of meat.
Once the sea scorpion had penetrated the outer shell of its prey, it would have made short work of the flesh inside. And so these aquatic monsters, possibly armed with metal-reinforced claws, like today's modern scorpions, were the world's first large predators. If you're going to bite something, you've got to be able to catch it first. So how does a 45-foot predator, the size of a large shipping container, keep up with its prey? The secret must lie in their four boat-sized flippers. The closest match to a pliosaurus flipper today belongs to a creature far less frightening. Penguins may look funny when they waddle on land, but underwater, they're like rockets, whizzing around at speeds of up to 20 miles per hour. Biomechanics expert Flavio Noca is trying to understand how they reach these extraordinary speeds. Using a high-speed camera, he films penguins moving around underwater.
This camera is actually able to go up to 12,000 images per second.
Flavio's footage reveals that penguins aren't swimming with their flippers. They are flapping them like a bird. And by twisting their wings as they flap, penguins can propel themselves forward on the upstroke, as well as the downstroke. The pliosaurs had not two, but four flippers, and they were gigantic. All signs point to this mega monster being not only one of the biggest, but also one of the fastest predators in the ocean. Aerospace engineer Luke Musket is investigating how they moved. Using X-rays of fossils, Luke has recreated a pair of pliosaur flippers.
Pliosaurs were really good swimmers, and the aim of the game is to chase down the prey. And obviously, to do that, you need to be very fast. You need to have a high thrust and a high acceleration.
By suspending the wings in a tank, he's trying to determine how the front and back wings work together to propel the pliosaurus. Blue and red dyes reveal how each wing moves the water. By harnessing the wake of the front wing, the pliosaurus could generate 2.5 times as much thrust as it would with just one set of wings. And that is how this mega beast gained sudden and tremendous acceleration. Its prey wouldn't have stood a chance. Cage diving, getting up close and personal with the most notorious modern-day predator, can be an unnerving experience. One ton of great white shark makes quite an impression. But just imagine, 360 million years ago, encountering a beast twice as long, over 3 times as heavy, and with jaws like a razor-sharp guillotine. Meet Dunkleosteus, maybe the fiercest fish that ever lived. At more than 25 feet, a full-grown Dunkleosteus was almost as long as a London bus. And at over 3 tons, twice the weight of a compact automobile. And it was very likely a cannibal too, preying on smaller specimens, weighing maybe 400 pounds. With his ferocious appetite, Dunkleosteus remained top of the food chain for some 20 million years. Dunkleosteus was truly a killing machine. With jaws so powerful, nothing could withstand them. So let's revisit our imaginary cage divers, about to look death in the face.
Although Dunkleosteus looks very big and the bones are very heavy, it was a very fast biter. The time it took for the jaws to open and then to close again around a prey item was 50 to 60 milliseconds.
Those massive jaws opened and shut in less than half the time it takes to blink your eye. Here it is, slowed down 30 times. And here it is, in real time. An incredible feat. But why so fast? A researcher who studied how these lionfish feed thinks he may have the answer.
But what's happening is they're opening their mouths as wide as they can, as quickly as they can. This creates suction pressure that actually causes water from outside to flow into the mouth. And anything in that water, in this case, these small pieces of fish, being thrown in are brought in with it. So in a lot of ways, Dunkleosteus had almost a prototype version of suction feeding.